Recording is started. Let me share the things with you people. Okay, let me first share the syllabus what you have. Let me just share this. Okay, this is the AMCD syllabus. Of course, I'll share all the details of this one. So let me just make it slightly bold. Okay, here I'll be giving the page number in the reference book so that you can easily refer, okay, what we are studying. So of course the outcomes of this particular course, okay, after you study this course, so you as a student will be able to understand MOSFET structure, its working, so how to write the small signal model of the MOSFET, and all of you can able to design and analyze, we call it as CSCGCD. They stands for common source, common gate and common drain amplifiers, and of course you can able to design and analyze also. And the third one is you can able to design and analyze differential amplifiers, and you can analyze its non-ideal characteristics. Non-idealities you can able to find out, okay, if it is non-ideal, how does it behave, you can able to very clearly understand. And then fifth outcome would be all of you can able to design a power supply, understand wave shaping circuits using diodes. So you might have learnt diode and its characteristics. Now we'll be using that for shaping the waveforms. So, and of course to design a power supply. Diode is an initial part of it. Afterwards we have so many other components which will be useful for designing a good power supply. And then at the last, okay, you can able to design an op amp based simple applications like, okay, amplifiers, voltage followers, and so many other applications you can able to do it. Coming to split up of these are the outcomes what you're planning, and as you know, we're going to have 39 hours is the allocated time to do this entire course. We have only 3 credits for this one, and we have this 2+1. So this 2 is actually theory hours, and 1 into 2, that is 1 lab hour of 2 hours duration. So this is for the entire class. So this is exclusive to your analog electronics lab that you'll be having exclusively, that is batch wise. So maybe 20 or 15 students in a batch, whereas the lab for this particular AMCD will be for the entire class. So by the way, okay, AMCD stands for, okay, analog MOS circuits design. So of course the entire course is revolving around MOSFET, and we'll be designing circuits using that MOSFET. Starting with unit 1, so because we have a simulation associated with this particular course, we're going to have theory as well as a simulation practice, so that they'll go hand in hand, so that you can easily understand the concept that you have learnt in your theory, you can able to visualize that in simulations. So these are the first unit components. So it is basically the MOSFET principles, the IV characteristics of MOSFET, how to use MOSFET as an amplifier. So okay, whenever you want to use a MOSFET as an amplifier, so you're supposed to bias it. So what are the biasing of amplifiers, and how do we analyze that? So using this small signal model, and then comes directly the design of common source amplifiers, and what are the MOSFET internal capacitance associated with the structure of MOSFET, and what is the frequency response of the MOSFET as an amplifier. So they have been split in different theory and what simulation modules. So this is how it is going. And then coming to second unit, so it is again the continuation of same MOSFET. As I said, this is fully of MOSFET. So by the end of this course, so you'll be comfortable with writing any circuit using MOSFET. So we have something like, okay, current mirrors, current mirror amplifiers with active loads. Again, common gate, common drain amplifiers, there are cascode amplifiers. So of course these are all totally new words for you people, but as time progresses, you can easily understand all these concepts very comfortably. Of course we have a third unit which is very interesting, and of course, very easy to, of course, all of them are very easy to score marks if you know it to the core. And of course, we have this differential amplifiers where if you know that CS amplifier thoroughly, CS, CD and CG amplifiers, working with this differential amplifier is so easy. So it's just like a cakewalk for all of you people if you thoroughly understand first units. And in unit 4, we have this diode models and circuits and applications of diode. So when I say applications of diode, this actually corresponds to the wave shaping circuits, maybe the design of power supply, all those things. And lastly, we have this op amp applications and power amplifiers. So this is the stuff what you have. Because maybe these hours had to be slightly modified, otherwise this is fine. The textbook for this particular course is Fundamentals of Microelectronics by Behad Razavi. I have a soft copy of this one. So once our Moodle is up, I'm going to share that with all of you. So that, of course, on the right hand side of each of the unit, we'll be specifying from which particular page we'll be referring the topic corresponding to this, so that you can refer on a daily basis. So what topic is covered from which concept, which chapter of this particular textbook. This is the major textbook, which covers almost 60% of the syllabus. And we have one more textbook. Now, these textbooks are pretty standard one. So they're not like your V2 textbooks. And we don't have any shortcut for this one. The only shortcut is you just go through the concepts, go through the topics on a daily basis. So you cannot get all these concepts as a capsule, so that you can able to swallow, and then maybe a day or two before the quiz or test, you cannot do it, but you have to be on your toes on a daily basis. I can see people are leaving, and so let me just see how many of you are there. Okay, 51. Let me just scroll through. Let me just record all of you. Okay, how many of you are there? Just a minute, I'll do that. So this is important for me, so that I can able to take the attendance on a daily basis. Even though I'm not calling you people with the name what you are registered, what you are logged into this particular class, so I can get to know who has logged in, who has not logged in. Okay, this is done. And we have one more important textbook, that is Cedra Smith, that is Adele S. Cedra and Carl S. Smith. This is Smith. We call it as Cedra Smith, Cedra and Smith. So again, this is a microelectronics textbook, Oxford University. These are all very standard textbooks referred all over the world for this particular microelectronic course. And of course, this is a reference book. If you want to refer to any specific concepts, you can just go to this one. And simulation, we'll be basically using LTSpice. If any student is interested in going to slightly higher level, so we can also introduce HSpice as a simulation tool. So this is the entire five modules, how it has been split up. And let me just also take you to, I can also show you the textbook. Okay, there's no point in showing the textbook. So let us straight away start with MOSFET characteristics. Okay, how does the working principle of MOSFET and all those things. So let me start the class straight away. Let me just share this. Where is okay, microphone. Okay, I will share for your information. We have around 60 to 70 video recordings done for this particular course. Whatever that I'll be teaching on a daily basis, it has been recorded earlier. You can able to refer to that particular recordings. So if you have any doubts, you can reach me out at any point of time. If you are attending the classes regularly, and if you are going through the videos, and then if you are referring to the textbook, so there is no reason why someone should find this AMCD difficult. I know you might have got a good or a tough opinion about this particular course from your seniors, so not all of them. Of course, you might have also got advice from your seniors that okay, you need to be attentive for this particular course, otherwise you will really find it difficult. And if you are very attentive, it is like a cakewalk. Suppose if you miss first 2 to 3 weeks, then it's very difficult to come out from that particular loop of difficulty. So make sure that you are there on your toes for the first 15 to 20 days so that you can feel very comfortable with this course. Okay, now the reference for this MOSFET basics is obtained from Behad Razavi. Okay, this is let me just take one student with me so that I can able to talk with the entire class. I'll go with whom shall I go? So let me just pick whom shall I pick? Kusuma R. I think she's for the first time. I'm just picking. That's fine.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, fine. Done. So this is, of course, is that fine, Mike?
Yes, sir.
Okay. We'll be discussing MOS capacitor. So we know that a capacitor, a parallel plate capacitor, all of you know. So it is going to have two plates. So in between that there is a spacing, and that spacing is usually filled with dielectric material. Am I correct?
Yes, sir.
Maybe you can just hold your mic stationary so that I cannot get that.
Okay, sir.
You just hang it down so that you don't touch your mic all the time. Okay, now you can see this is a capacitor. Forget about mass capacitor, simply take it as capacitor, or shall I say capacitor as two plates and separated by some distance and filled with the insulator.
Yes, sir.
That's what a metal capacitor is. Why the name MOS? So don't simply say it as MOS. So this M is coming from metal, O is coming from oxide, S is coming from semiconductor. So this is metal oxide semiconductor capacitor. So I want all of you to write it in your notebook. MOS capacitor actually stands for metal oxide semiconductor capacitor. So where is this metal? Where is this oxide? Where is this semiconductor? So if you consider this as a MOS capacitor, this top, that is conducting plate, happens to be the metal, and the bottom plate happens to be the semiconductor, which is in this particular case p-type silicon, and in between that I have got a insulator, that is oxide. Oxide is an insulator, no?
Yes, sir.
Oxide is an insulator. So we are referring this type of capacitor, which is constituted using a metal oxide and a semiconductor as MOS capacitor. Perfect. So you don't have two plates with metal, but one of the plate is metal, the other one is semiconductor, and in between you have the oxide, that is as an insulator. So this is how easy the structure of your MOS capacitor is. And we know that to this capacitor, if you apply plus onto one battery, plus of the battery is connected to one of the plate, if you connect the negative of the battery to one more plate of the capacitor, you can see because of this you have plus charges, and the negative charges will be created on the other plate. Correct?
Yes,
so
sir.
Whenever you apply positive voltage, you're going to have plus on the top, and then you're going to have negative charges, which is in the form of electrons, because we know that this is a silicon. So p-type silicon, who is there with me? This is what's your name?
Kusuma, sir.
Kusuma, fine. Kusuma, okay. What is the majority carriers in p-type silicon?
Holes.
Perfect. So now, even though the holes are majority carriers for this p-type silicon, because of this application of positive voltage on one plate of the capacitor, we actually get electrons being accumulated at the interface. So I will say interface as the it is the intersection between this oxide and semiconductor. So shall I say this point as oxide semiconductor interface?
Yes, sir.
Interface is where, because they are all both of them are meeting at some point, no? So very close,
yes,
to that we call it as interface, meaning whenever I apply positive voltage onto one end of the MOS capacitor, on the other side at the oxide semiconductor interface, I will have electrons being collected. Electrons being collected because we know that for a capacitor, when you apply positive onto one plate and the other plate, you are supposed to get negative. If you apply the negative on one plate, you have to get the positive on the other plate. So since you applied positive here, you are getting negative. How you are getting that negative charges? That negative charges are coming due to what? Electrons in this p-type. So even though electrons are minority carriers, they'll be attracted towards this particular interface junction of oxide and semiconductor. Done?
Yes,
now
sir.
You can see I have one voltage source V1. Let me put one more voltage source V2, which is in this way. See now, I have V1, which is for making these electrons to come over here. I will make an arrangement so that I will apply one more battery on either side, on horizontal side. So you can see there are two potentials. One is V1 for developing the electrons at the interface, and one more source V2 so that I can use this electrons for current movement. So I can use this electron as a channel for moving the electrons for creating the current. How does electrons move from which direction to which direction, from where to where? Will it go from negative to positive? Because this
positive
is negative.
No.
Electron movement. You can see this is negative, yeah. So electrons will be repelled from here. Correct? They are moving from left to right. So whatever arrow mark that is shown is what? The direction of movement of electrons. How does the current is going now? Current is exactly the opposite direction. Current is in the direction opposite of electron movement. So basically what we are trying to understand from this MOS capacitor is how does a MOS capacitor is constructed?
MOS capacitor is constructed as the it have two plates.
Fine.
One is metal, one is oxide, and another one is semiconductor.
Okay. Now, between two plates, you have the oxide, which is an insulator. Instead of having two metal plates, one of them is metal, the other one is?
Another one is semiconductor.
Semiconductor, perfect. And then by applying voltage?
When the voltage is applied, the minority charge carrier, the electrons are assembled at the interface of the insulator and silicon.
Perfect. So what you can say is, if positive charges are applied at the metal plate, at the oxide semiconductor interface, I will have electrons being accumulated there. So electrons will get, they'll going to come close to that oxide interface, oxide semiconductor interface, so that when you apply voltage V2, there is a possibility of current. Assume that if I make this V1 as zero, assume that V1 becomes zero. So then do you have this current, do you have these electrons coming here?
No, sir.
It won't come. When electrons are not there, the movement of current will not happen. The movement of electrons will not happen. Because since electrons are minority in nature, you will not have too many electrons over here when this voltage is zero. So in order to have current to flow, first you should have electrons being assembled here. How does electrons will assemble?
When voltage is applied.
When V1 is applied with this polarity, that is very important. The polarity
positive
should be plus, this should be minus. Only when the metal plate gets plus, you can have electrons at the other plate. Now, once you have electrons, then you can think of applying voltage source so that electrons can move, so that current can flow in the circuit. Done?
Yes, sir.
Okay, this is what is the concept. Let us see what happens next. See, this is the MOSFET structure. So that was a MOS capacitor. Now you have a MOSFET. So what is MOSFET now? It is metal oxide semiconductor field effect transistor. FET stands for field effect transistor. I want all of you to just have a Just write this cross section view. This is the 3D view of that. This is the 3D view, and this is the no need to take too much time to write this 3D view. just take this, okay, cross section view, and this is the symbol. So how many terminals are there for this MOSFET structure now?
Three.
There are three terminals. We have gate, we have source and drain. Drain. So this is source, drain and gate. Can you see there is a MOS capacitor here? This gate is one of the metal plate, and this bulk, we call it as bulk. So this bottom portion. So this bottom portion is semiconductor, and can you see this is insulator?
Yes, sir.
There is an insulator. Now you know that you are supposed to connect that second battery, correct?
Yes, sir.
Instead of connecting the second battery like this, I'll be these two whatever contacts you have, that I'm trying to establish using this and this, correct? So
yes,
I can connect the battery between source and the drain, so that the battery will be applied between this end and this end, so that current can flow from flow across this particular source and drain.
Okay.
Just see the symbol of this MOSFET. Since it is a P substrate, we call this MOSFET as N MOSFET. In case of N MOSFET, source and drain are of N type, and substrate is of P type. All of you note down, in case of NMOS structure, we have source and drain, they are NMOS,
N type,
and the substrate is
P type.
You can also notice that it is not simply P type, sorry, it's not only N type, it is written as N plus. Can you all notice that N plus?
Yes, sir.
And this P, no, it's actually P minus substrate. So there is some reason for writing that as N plus P minus. N plus, okay, I think all of you are knowing about the doping concentration, impurity level. Heard of it?
Yes, sir.
Now you have a pure semiconductor. Now you start adding the impurity. Either it can be boron, phosphorus, depending on which type of semiconductor you want. Suppose if the impurity added is more and more, then it becomes plus. Now N plus actually stands for, it is, okay, to get N type, okay, to semiconductor, to silicon, what you are supposed to add? Pentavalent or trivalent?
Pentavalent.
What is the material? Phosphorus.
So,
which material should be added to get n-type to silicon?
So phosphorus.
Phosphorus. So is she correct? Can somebody chat in the chat box? Okay, what are the materials that can be added to silicon to get n-type material? I just noted, okay, whoever chats, whoever gives the correct answer will be positively noted, and then arsenic, then. Okay, phosphorus, aluminum, then antimony. No, typically germanium is not added. Germanium is boron. No, boron is for what? Boron is a trivalent or pentavalent? One of you give me what is boron. Boron is tri or pentavalent? Because some of you are typing it as boron. To get. So boron is trivalent, then you cannot add boron to silicon to get N. Now make all these things very clear. To get N type semiconductor for silicon, you have to add a pentavalent, which can be phosphorus. If you add more and more phosphorus, then it becomes N plus. If you add less number, it will become N minus. So here you can see for P minus, what is the base for P substrate? It is a silicon. What you are adding to this? What impurity you are adding for P type to get P type? To get P type, what you'll be adding? Boron, no? if you add boron, which is a trivalent, so that it will become p-type. You add less quantity of boron, it will become p minus substrate. You add large quantity of phosphorus, it will become n plus. Correct. So that's what is this here. So all of you, now from now onwards, you cannot simply say n-type, p-type. For this source and drain, they have to be n plus, whereas for the substrate it should be p minus. Let us see the concentration levels and all those things maybe in the coming classes. Okay, this is the now you can see for n-type material, the source will always have an arrow mark, and it is coming out of this particular thing. So it's actually coming out. So the source terminal is always going to have an arrow mark, and that arrow mark is coming out for what? N-type. For p-type, for the same source, you'll have an arrow mark, but that will be going into the gate, into the device. If it is n-type, it is coming out. If it is p-type, it is going in. And you can see this is again, wherever arrow mark is there, it is the source, and wherever this isolation is there, it is gate. The other terminal is drain. Let me see. These are all typical dimensions. Can you see? Can you just think of what the dimension of all these things? So this is typical. May not be today's. This textbook is maybe around 5 to 6 years old. Today's dimensions, the length happens to be in terms of 18 nanometer, 20 nanometer. That is the length. What I'm talking about is length of the channel. Can you see what is the oxide thickness? What is the oxide thickness?
18 angstrom.
18 angstrom. It is 10 power minus 10. So even that is also keep reducing. It's around 8 to 10 angstrom now. Just to give a comparison to the thickness of our hair, thickness of our hair is around 10 to 15 microns. 10 to 15 microns. So you just think of where does this 20 nanometer and 90 nanometer dimensions will be. So they are very, very, very tiny in nature. The dimensions are so less, you cannot see all these things using naked eyes. The dimension, you can see this dimension, it is in terms of angstrom, they need to be very precisely fabricated during the fabrication process. So these are the typical dimensions of a MOSFET. There is a source, there is a drain. You can see it is written as, even though it is written as source and drain, but they are interchangeable. Correct?
Yes, sir.
I can name this as drain, and I can name this as source, because look symmetrical? Because either you name this as drain or source, or this as source or drain, doesn't matter. But in the symbol, wherever that arrow mark is there, that is always source. You cannot interchange the symbol here. So while writing the symbol, the arrow mark will always indicate the source. And of course, this is gate and this is drain. So it is not necessary to write all the time, okay, this is source, that is gate, this is drain. This arrow mark always indicates it's a source terminal of your MOSFET. Okay, that's why it is called as S bar D diffusion. Diffusion means the process of making that silicon to N plus. Okay, now let us go to the MOSFET operation. So we were just talking about that. What is that? MOSFET structure, no? MOS capacitor. Now we can see. Let me just relate it to this. Do you see this here? This is a MOS capacitor having one metal plate. Positive. This is a semiconductor. Applied the positive voltage. Just see how does this looks like. Does this look the same here? You can see there is a metal oxide semiconductor.
Semiconductor.
I am applying positive to this, and this is grounded. When this bottom is grounded, this is grounded. Is it like applying something like this? Correct?
Yes, sir.
So if you apply some voltage here, can you see now, is this the symbol here? Can you see this is source, this is drain, are both of them grounded?
Yes, sir.
This is source, this is drain, this is ground, this is ground. This is symbolically, it is represented. To the gate, you applied a VG source. To the gate, you applied a VG source. And fine. Now, okay, let me just, okay, now how do I explain now? It now requires some, okay. Before this, in a p-type semiconductor, so let me just give me some time so that I can take the camera and then place it over here. Okay, that I'll do it in the next hour. So before that, okay, let us try to understand, okay, what is happening. So this is the MOSFET operation. Let me first apply small voltage to this, because when I apply small positive voltage, do you get some negative charges here?
Yes, sir.
So as we saw here, when you apply, sorry, when you apply some positive voltage, you're getting negative charges. Same thing is happening here also, correct?
Yes,
now
sir.
This is when you apply lesser voltage. Can you see this is negative with some, okay, circle, negative with some circle?
Yes, sir.
So we'll just talk about this maybe in the next hour, but you simply just notice that this is a negative with circle when you apply less voltage, and we call it as depletion region. So now you're not understanding why it is called as depletion region. Maybe I'll just clarify this in the next hour. Now, suppose if you apply more and more voltage, you can see it is the same, it's the same circuit. See here? Isn't it change the circuit from B to C?
No, sir.
Only change is the applied voltage is more.
More.
When the applied voltage is more, you can see the changes from this negative charges to this negative charges. Now, when you have more and more plus, would you like to have compensation from more and more negative on the other side?
Yes, sir.
Because when you have plus on one side, the negative has to come because of capacitive action on the other side also. You can see you're getting that negative charges here. See the difference between this negative and this negative. So do you have these things still retained here?
Yes, sir, they are retained.
But along with that, you have these negative also. They are all called as free electrons. Of course, I'll just clarify, okay, how does this free electrons comes? Okay, why there are no free electrons over here? I'll explain you people all those things in the 11 o'clock class. So for lesser voltages, there are no free electrons, but there are some negative charges, because capacitive action has to be satisfied. If you have plus charge here, you need to have negative charge on the other side. So initially, you will be satisfying the negative charges using ions. When the voltage is more and more, you cannot get more and more ions. So you're going to compensate the negative charges in the form of free electrons.
Free electrons.
In the form of free electrons. So now, do we have this N plus and this N plus joined using electrons?
Yes, sir.
So now, shall I say there is a channel of electrons existing between the source and the drain?
Yes, sir.
Now, here you can see, here also there is a negative charge that is connecting, but since it is immobile ions, the electrons cannot move here. Of course, these are all immobile, they cannot move. Whereas here, they are free electrons, they can move now.
Perfect.
They can move now. So let us see what happens next. See. What is this here?
So?
Just have a look at difference between this circuit and that circuit. You can see both source and drain are grounded. Correct?
Yes, sir.
See here, this circuit. You have this gate as it is. Source is still grounded, but this is not grounded, but you have a voltage source connected.
Voltage.
Can you see the difference between this circuit and this circuit?
Yes, sir.
You can see you have a voltage source. You have a voltage source. Now, as we saw it here, now we can see, do you have a voltage source on either side here? You have,
yes,
V1,
sir.
And V2.
And V2.
So shall I just come back and say, which is analogous to V1 there? Sorry. Is it VG?
So VG.
Which is analogous to V2?
VD.
VD, perfect. So when you have VG along with VD, there is a possibility of current flowing from drain to source. See here, now the current is moving now. How does the current move? It goes into drain and then reaches the source and ground. So because you need to have a closed path, no?
Yes, sir.
So because you have a battery, from positive terminal of the battery, current enters the drain and it goes to source and then goes to ground. Goes to ground. There is a closed path from power supply to ground through this MOSFET, that is from drain through the channel. So when the channel is existing, when does the channel of electrons exist?
When voltage supplies more.
When you apply voltage. Sufficient voltage. If you apply less voltage, there is no electrons. In such case, current won't flow. Only when you apply sufficient voltage, the electron channel is created, then only the current will flow. That's what is here put. See here. So assume that you have VG. Which is VG? It is this. Correct?
Even. Yes, sir.
So this VD is fixed. VD, assume that you have fixed it. VD is around 2 volts. So you have applied 2 volts, but VG is 0. VG is 0. Can the current flow?
Current flow will be more.
No. See here, this is 2 volt.
Yes, sir.
This is 0 volt. So let me just go back to this circuit. Suppose if I don't apply any voltage, will you get any charges? Because here nothing is there. Sir. Why are you getting these negative ions?
Because of the less applied voltage.
No. You are certainly applying some voltage here.
Yes,
since
sir.
You applied some voltage, that's why it is negative. Suppose if you don't apply anything?
Sir, there will be no ions.
Nothing. There will be no
ions.
It will
be holes.
No, it will.
Yes, sir.
Electrons or the negative ions will not be there because there will be no capacitive action.
Yes, sir.
Am I correct? Meaning?
Yes, sir.
If I make this VG equal to 0, even though I apply the voltage, can the current flow from drain to source?
No, sir.
That's why the current is 0. See here?
Yes.
Why the current is 0? Even though you apply sufficient VD, even though you apply sufficient VD, I'm changing VG. Here you can see, I'm just varying. Of course, all of you very carefully notice the diagram here. VD is kept constant. VG is now varied. VG is now varied. Let me just pick one more student. And okay, now you're there with me for a long time. Let me pick whom to pick. Sonu Bhatt. Sonu Bhatt.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Now,
yes, sir.
You can.
Am I audible, sir?
You are. It can be fine. Okay, now, what we are trying to see here is, we have seen, let me just,
yes, sir.
Carefully observe this circuit diagram. VD is fixed, whereas VG is varying. Now, let us assume that VD is
yes,
2
sir.
Volt. So, I have applied 2 volt here, but VG is started from 0. Now, assume that you applied 0.1, 0.2, 0.3. When you apply lesser voltage, do you have these ions coming here? These ions?
No, sir.
No. Ions will come because you applied slight positive voltage on one plate of the MOS cap. Correct?
Okay.
See here.
Yes, sir.
This is a MOS capacitor. If you apply, assume that you apply only plus one, one plus. So will you get one minus? Hello?
Yes, sir.
So meaning for lesser voltages.
Hello?
For lesser voltages, you will get first ions. So that's what is coming here. Even though ions are there for lower voltages, current is zero because ions
yes,
cannot move. Ions cannot move because ions are bound to each other. So that's why initially the current is zero even though when VG is positive. Now, assume that you have increased
yes.
the voltage to a
yes,
greater
sir.
Extent. So that you have electrons
yes,
being
sir.
Accumulated. Electrons being accumulated. When the electrons are being accumulated, because of this applied voltage, can the electrons move from source to drain? No, can the electrons now move from source to drain because of this applied voltage? See now, why these electrons have been collected here? Because of what? Because of VG or because of VD? These electrons. Are you lost? सोनू जी, हेलो। हेलो सोनू, लास्ट। ओके, लेट मी पिक। नौशीन बानू, हु
यस सर,
इज दिस? सोनू, हु इज दिस?
हेलो सर,
या आर यू
सर
देयर?
योर वॉइस इज नॉट क्लियर सर, कैन
माय
यू प्लीज,
वॉइस? नो, आई एम जस्ट आस्किंग यू,
हेलो
यू आर ऑडिबल? एम आई नॉट ऑडिबल टू यू?
हेलो सर, सर
हेलो।
हेलो
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 जी,
सर, हेलो
जस्ट जस्ट वन ऑफ यू टाइप मी, एम आई ऑडिबल और नॉट? समहाउ सोनू इज शाउटिंग एट मी।
हेलो
ओके, वी विल जॉइन एट 11 o'clock। इट्स
हेलो
ऑलमोस्ट
यस सर,
11:45। वी विल जॉइन एट 11।
सोनू सर,
ओके फाइन, वी विल जॉइन एट 11।
यस सर,
ओके ओके फाइन।
यस सर, सर योर वॉइस इज ब्रेकिंग सर, हेलो हेलो
ओके। Okay.